have your Bible, I invite you to turn to Daniel chapter 1. You'll see listed in the bulletin that Daniel, we have chapters 1, verses 1 through 3. Occasionally at this church, we'll have different activities or special things showing that we add to the service. Last Sunday, we had a time where we recognized our students going up from children into the youth department. Sometimes we'll show special videos. And anytime, I'll let him remain nameless, but anytime one of my sons knows that something special or different is happening in the service, he'll say, "Does that mean your sermon's going to be shorter?"
Amen.
Amen. Some of you may be feeling the way he does, saying we're only looking at three verses a day, but we are not going to have much of a shorter sermon because these three verses that we're looking at today are packed with important information. There's a history that goes into the first three verses of Daniel. I want to just read these three verses before I tell you the history that goes along with it. It says, "In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. Then the king commanded Ashpenaz, his chief eunuch, to bring some of the people of Israel, both of the royal family and of nobility, saying that they were youths skilled with blemish." This goes into last Sunday's sermon. "They were taken into captivity." Let's pause and pray that God will inspire us with this passage. Heavenly Father, as we read these words, they may seem like mere introduction to the story of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But Heavenly Father, we see much happening in this passage that should both challenge us as a nation, but give us security as believers because it speaks of your sovereignty. We pray today that you remind us of your sovereign will over the nations and how we can be a part either of your blessings and your actions and your activities, or if we ignore you, receive your judgments. We pray for this service in Jesus' name. Amen. Allow me to give you some of the history of what's going on in this passage. Last Sunday, we looked at Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego on how they were taken captive, how they did not eat of the king's food because it would be morally against what they knew from their upbringing. We looked at how they wanted to remain pure in their identity, their education, and their practices. But before that happened, they were taken into captivity under King Jehoiakim. Jehoiakim was not a good king. He was a king of the southern kingdoms. At this time in the history of Israel, Israel had been divided into the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, and the northern kingdom had already been obliterated by the Assyrians. They were taken into Assyrian captivity, and the northern 10 tribes of Judah were gone. You had left the southern kingdom, and you had a king who was doing wrong in the eyes of the Lord. This was nothing new. Plenty of kings of Israel had done wrong in the eyes of the Lord. Jehoiakim's father had been a good king. He had tried to follow the Lord and do what the Lord commanded. But he was replaced by his other son who did evil in the sight of the Lord. His brother went to try and battle the Egyptians, and the Egyptians took him captive. And the Egyptian pharaoh, Necho, put Jehoiakim in the throne. You have what happens in the nation of Israel. A foreign power put someone in control of Israel. And he served as a vassal king or as a puppet king. Egypt said, you can be in charge, but you have to pay us lots of money. So Jehoiakim, being a king of Israel, decided to appease Egypt and put the burden of paying these heavy, heavy financial obligations upon the people of Israel. We're not told everything that Jehoiakim did that was evil, but we know, again, that kings throughout their history have been doing terrible things. They had been allowing the people to worship other deities. They themselves had worshipped foreign gods. They had brought the idols of foreign deities into their own temple of God. They abused the people. They took advantage of them. They did not listen to God's ways nor follow Him. And for years upon decades, prophets would go to the king of Israel and they would say, you need to change. If you don't change, if our people don't change, God is going to take the people into captivity. Jeremiah himself said, the Babylonians are going to do this. If you don't change. I want to read for you. You just listen to this. This comes from Jeremiah chapter 7. This was some of the evil that was taking place in the land. This is, if you want to turn, it's Jeremiah chapter 7. It says, the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word and say, hear the word of the Lord, all you men of Judah who enter these gates to worship the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, amend your ways and your deeds, and I will let you dwell in this place. Do not trust these deceptive words. This is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. Let me pause there and explain what's happening here. We see in this short passage, again in Jeremiah chapter 7, two things happening about the relationship that the people had with God. There was the dwelling place, and there was the temple. When you think back further into the history of Israel, you will remember that when they came out of the land of Egypt, God said that I will give you the promised land. And you will dwell there, and you will be my people, and I will be your God. This was a promise God gave them, but it was a conditional promise. We understand conditional promises. We understand conditional agreements. We live our lives like that. Parents to children, clean your room, and if you get an allowance or you get money for doing chores, clean your room or do this chore, and I will give you this certain amount of money. Don't clean your room, and I will give you this certain type of punishment. If you do this, I will do this. There's this agreement in our school system. If you make these grades, you'll go to the next grade, or if you make these grades, you'll get this on your test. Our jobs, if you work this certain amount of hours and do this certain job, you'll make this certain amount of money. If you don't do this job, you don't work these hours, you won't get this money. We understand these kind of arrangements. God had this kind of arrangement with Israel. He promised He would be their God, but He said, you must follow me and obey my commandments. If you do that, I will dwell among you and be your God. And you will have possession of this land. And as time went on and they got a king, they were promised that someone from the house of David would always be on the throne to look and keep charge over the people. Three things were very important to the people of Israel at this time: their land, their temple, and the king. The land, again, was a promised land. The temple, we hear about the temple. We know the temple was a place that they went and they worshiped. But for Israel, the temple was so much more. There's a phrase that is not in the Bible, but we use it, called the Shekinah glory. Has anybody ever heard the phrase Shekinah? Some of you hear that phrase. Again, it's not specifically a biblical term, but it's a way we talk about the presence of God. The presence of God was a visible manifestation of the glory of God that stayed in the Holy of Holies. It could be seen by the people. They knew that God's glory dwelled there in the temple. And they thought that what began to happen is they thought God had to stay there. We have this temple. The glory of God dwells there. He's here with us always. And what happened is they would say, well, you know what? God's here with us. It doesn't matter if we worship pagan deities, because we can still see the presence of God. So they would live terrible lives, but then say, the glory of God is here. The temple for them was not just a place they went and worshiped. It was a dwelling place of God. And they thought they would always have it. And then again, the king, the promise, the protector, the one God said that I will establish you, and your lineage will serve as leader of my people. But these were conditional promises. What was happening, as I read in Jeremiah, is the people were doing evil in the sight of the Lord, but they were saying, but the temple of God, the temple of God, the temple of God. Almost as if to say, it didn't matter what the prophet Jeremiah said and that they needed to change their ways. They said, well, we've got the temple. As if the structure itself was enough to protect them from their evil ways, because God remained faithful. Here's what Jeremiah said to the people. Do not trust these deceptive words. This is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. For if you truly amend your ways and your deeds, if you truly execute justice one with another, if you do not oppose the sojourner, the fatherless, or the widow, or shed innocent blood in this place, if you do not go after other gods to your own harm, then I will let you dwell in this place, in the land that I gave of old to your fathers forever. In these warnings are examples of what they were doing. They were not executing justice. They were not being faithful with one another. They were opposing the sojourner, or some of your translations, if you look in there, may say refugee. They were abusing the fatherless. They were not taking care. They were oppressing the widow. They were shedding innocent blood. This is what was happening in the land of Israel. Jeremiah, for 40 years, tried to get them to change their ways. He wrote a letter specifically to King Jehoiakim, telling Jehoiakim, if you don't change, then the land is going to be given to the people of Babylon. Do you know how Jehoiakim responds? He takes the scroll, he rips it up, and he throws it into the fire. This king who did evil in the sight of the Lord, who was put there by a foreign power, would not even listen to the corrective words of the prophet Jeremiah. So, when we look back at our passage, at first, he's the puppet of Egypt. And then Babylon, this growing empire, this growing military presence and power in this region, begins to go to war with Egypt. And they go and they lay siege in Jerusalem. And that happens in about 605 BC. Nebuchadnezzar took King Jehoiakim prisoner. And there's a little bit of variation on understanding what happens here, but he was either taken to Babylon as a prisoner, or he was simply established as a puppet king, no longer for Egypt, but now for Babylon. For the 3 years, he paid tribute now to Babylon. After 3 years, he tried to revolt along with Egypt and tried to find freedom from the Babylonian rule. But he hadn't changed his ways. He's already under the oppressive control of Babylon. He tries to rebel, but instead Babylon raids and takes captive the young men. This is where Daniel comes in. This is where the story comes in with them, and takes them captive. The story with Israel doesn't end there. What we're seeing here is the beginning of the end of Judah. Because after this, and you can look at these dates later, in 597, King Nebuchadnezzar again besieges the city. And he carries away all the treasures of the house of the Lord and all the treasures of the king's palace, and takes with him 10,000 captives and all the craftsmen and all the silversmiths. And this leaves just a remnant of the poorest of the poor. It doesn't stop there. Later, another king tries to rebel against Babylon. So Babylon goes in, destroys the walls surrounding Jerusalem, destroys the temple, burns it to the ground. And all the leaders are killed, and anybody of any value is taken into captivity. Jerusalem is basically destroyed. Now, there's a few ways to look at this. One is simply, that's just the rise and fall of powers. We see that in our own world. We see nations rise up, and we see them defeated, and we see them go away. We see other nations rise up and try to assert themselves. We're seeing that right now in our world. Nations trying to threaten and rattle their sabers and their nuclear weapons. And some would say that's simply geographic or financial or the ebb and flow of society. But we, as Christians, need to see this in a different light. We need to see that there is a hand of God in this. Because what it says here, in going back to Daniel, what it says here in verse 2, "And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into Nebuchadnezzar's hands." This wasn't simply a battle. This wasn't simply happenstance. God had been telling the people for year after year after year after year, change, repent, take care of one another, follow the God that you serve, obey His commandments, don't oppress the widow, the refugee, the orphan, don't shed innocent blood. And they continued to do it, ignoring the prophets, ignoring the warnings, ignoring the fact that God said, "If you don't change, I am going to take you out of this land. I am no longer going to stay with you. I am no longer going to protect you." But they didn't do it. And so God fulfilled His promises. And the people were stripped from the land that they believed would always be theirs. Their kings were killed or taken captive, whom they always thought would be over them, protecting and ruling over them. And the temple, the visual representation of the dwelling of God, was destroyed. What is it that you hold? What is it that you think that because you want it enough that you are always going to be able to hang on to it? What is it in your life that you think is so secure that could never be stripped from your hand? Is it your house? Is it your family? Is it your job? Is it your reputation? Is it your character? What are these things that you're claiming hold of? So much so that it does, you just think that God's always going to give you the things because He always has. There's a warning here for us. There's a warning here for us as a nation. Now, I want to say this as a caveat. I believe that God had a special relationship with Israel. I do not believe that nations have the same type of relationship that Israel had with God. Now, we as Americans, we oftentimes say that America is a blessed and Christian nation. And regardless of the history of how we came to that understanding, though we are a Christian nation, or at least once were, I still don't think that gives us a special, unique relationship with God in the same way that Israel had a special, unique relationship with God. That does not negate the truth that God is still the God of the nations. In the New Testament, He is described as the God of the nations. So we, as a nation, need to be praying to God, but also asking ourselves, are we doing the very things that He commanded Israel not to do? Are we shedding innocent blood? And we think of all the different abortion clinics throughout our land. And we say, are we taking care of the refugee and the sojourners? And we think about all the people flooding our shores trying to find a sense of security. Are we taking care of the orphan? Are we watching out for the widow? Are we as a nation seeking God or other pleasures? Are we bringing things that don't belong in our lives into our lives? And the reason I say our lives is because of how we look at a passage like this in light of the New Testament. See, in the New Testament, we aren't promised land. We aren't promised a temple. We praise God for the fine church that we have and all the different buildings across our land where we gather together and worship. But even though we call this God's house, we don't look at this as there is a special, unique manifestation of God's glory like Israel had. We call this God's house because we as God's people come here and gather here. So actually, the New Testament, the temple, is not the fact that there's a building. We become the temple. Our body is the temple. When Jesus was on this earth, he was fully the embodiment of God. And we, through faith, through the Holy Spirit, we have this relationship with God. So that we, our bodies, are the temple of God. If we are believers and we are indwelled with the Holy Spirit. So Christ fulfills this promise in us, not in a physical structure, but in our own souls. Well, how about king? See, he made a promise to the people of Israel that they would be king. And moving from a relationship of nations to individuals, we also have a king, King Jesus, from the lineage of David. And he dwells in our hearts, and we follow him. How about land? Are we promised any particular place on this planet? No, but we have a different promise. A new heaven and a new earth. Scripture tells us that in my Father's house, Jesus said, are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. We are promised a place that we will be able to live eternally if we put our faith in Jesus Christ. We are told that we will follow after the king if we will sacrifice, and as Buddy said, sacrifice daily to take up the cross and follow him. And we're told that we will have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in our lives because Scripture says that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Those are his words. That's no longer conditional. For Israel, it was a conditional promise. For us, it is a promise that is fulfilled because of Christ's death on the cross. Our response is just to follow. Our responsibility is to submit. The conditions have been paid. And that's just what should bring us joy. Someone to guide, someone to lead, someone to speak on our behalf, someone who will give us a promise of eternity. That's what we have fulfilled. The promises that God gave Israel on the condition that they would follow him are fulfilled in Jesus Christ and can be ours if we will accept him as Savior and follow him with our lives. So on an individual level, we should celebrate that. And I hope you do. I hope that you have given your life over to Jesus Christ. You have put your trust and faith in him. You have said, God, I am unworthy. I am a sinner. I need you in my life, dear Jesus. Save me. I will trust you. I will follow you. I will try to live under your guidance. Heavenly Father, save me. I believe that Jesus' death on the cross paid for my sins and that there is an eternity forever if I will put my faith in you. I hope you've said that. And we will see these promises fulfilled in our lives. But as a nation, nations rise and nations fall. And God says to the nations that He is sovereign. So we need to be not just looking at our world, and when we think about a country like North Korea, we shouldn't just tremble in our boots. We should get down on our knees and pray that sovereign God would do His will, and that we as a nation would turn back to Him, and that we would stop shedding innocent blood, and that we would take care of the sojourners, and that we would watch out for those least fortunate among us, and we will reject anything that does not glorify His name. And that we should pray for our leaders. We should pray for our president, to sovereign God, that He would give our president wisdom, and that He would call him to do what is righteous in the sight of God. We should pray the same thing for other leaders of other nations. We have seen nations crumble. We need to go to God and pray for our nation that we would remain faithful. Now, America, again, I'm not saying there's any great promise, but I do think that if we as a nation will stay true to who God has called us to be as individuals, if we remain a light, I believe that God wants to have places where His name is glorified, where the truth of Jesus is shared, where people are following after Him and trying to be His hands and feet. So I pray that we will continue with the hope and with the desire to serve Him. And my hope is that as we follow after God, He will allow us to remain so that we continue to be a place where His name is glorified. So take comfort, believer, in knowing that God is sovereign over the nation. Take comfort, believer, knowing that the promises God gave to Israel are fulfilled by Jesus Christ in your own life of king, of temple, of location. If you're here today and you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, you've never confessed your sins to God and said, "I am a sinner. Please, God, save me. I trust in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ," then I hope you hear this sermon as a warning to you, because you do not have any conditional relationship with God. You don't have any assurance. You are not promised guidance or deliverance or blessing. You are not promised forgiveness. You are not promised a land until you put your hope and trust in Him. He has fulfilled the promises. Are you ready to accept them? I pray you'll do that today. We're seeing changes in our world. And I'll just say it like this. I don't want to get too gloomy. The truth that's always been the truth is we're never promised tomorrow. We see things happening on a global scale, and we know that something that happens across the sea can affect us financially. It can affect our safety. It can affect our way of life. We also know that we can go driving down the road, and someone who's not paying attention, cars can careen together, and loss of life can happen instantly. These promises are available to you now. Are you ready to confess your sins? Have you heard the word of the Lord and felt conviction in your own life? Because you know in your own soul that while you may not be out killing the innocent, you know that there is lust in your heart, or you know that there is greed, or you know that there is anger, or you know that you're clinging to the things that are outside of God's word that you think you're giving you comfort. You know the sins have taken control of your life, and you're ready to lay them down. Today, you can have that assurance of the promises that are conditional not upon you, but upon what Christ did on the cross. Are you ready today to invite him into your life and make him Savior and Lord? Meet me down front. Let's pray together. Let's pray that God will forgive you of your sins as he promises he will, as you give your life to him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we pray for our nation. You are God. You are in control. We read a warning in scriptures today, both from Jeremiah as well as from Daniel. You are sovereign. We don't know the future of this land. We don't know what you have in store for us. But God, we pray. We pray that you will speak and guide our leaders. We pray for our president. We pray for our Congress. We pray for our Supreme Court justices. We pray for our governors and our mayors and our leaders that they would seek you. We pray that they would look for ways to protect the innocent, to care for the least of these, to protect innocent life. We pray that you would speak to the hearts of other nations, the leaders of other lands, because you are sovereign over them as well. May this nation continue to be a place where your name is glorified, where the truth of who Jesus Christ is shared openly and often. Heavenly Father, we also pray for the people right here in this room. The people who, unlike our nation, we know what is in store for them. We know what is in store for each and every one of us. We have two options. We can spend eternity without God in suffering and anguish. Or today, we can seek to follow him and live the promises of leadership in our lives, of guidance, of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, and an eternity with him. It is your choice today. Repent, just as Jeremiah called out to the people. Repent. Don't say, well, I go to church. Don't say, well, I come here a lot. Don't say, well, my family is a Christian. That's like the people crying out, the temple, the temple. What you need to cry out is, my Jesus, my Savior, forgive me. Put your trust in him today. Let's pray about it. Let's confirm it. Let's settle it today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.